In this video, I'm going to answer a question that maybe you already have in your mind. How can I choose the proper methodology and method? So I will start first with the methodology. And while I am, I'm going to ask these questions, and maybe you can start answering to these questions already from your cases or the data that you already have. So first question, what is the ontological and epistemological stance that you have? So first, how do you define this phenomenon? As I said earlier, do you think that digital transformation is a matter of changes in technology? Maybe is it a matter of investment? Is it a matter of, I don't know what else, maybe software transformation, something like that? Is that really digital transformation? If that's the case, I think it's clear that you are going on the objective side of ontology and epistemology. If you think that digital transformation, a part of course, a technological transformation, it's also a transformation in the organization and the mindset of people and relationships between people and the structure of the organization, then it is more to the subjective part. I think you can already start answering to that question. Question number two, I'm going from philosophical questions to more empirical questions. So question number one, it's very philosophical. It's how do you define digital transformation in accounting? It's like, I'm going to go a little bit outside of the topic, but it's like, how do you define love? Is love only a matter of chemistry and chemical reactions in your body? Then positivistic approach. Is it more about feelings and relationships with people, and it's on the non-positivistic approach, the subjective approach. Let's call it the objective and subjective approach, okay? So next question is, what is the research question that you want to answer? It's like, what are you doing in there? Are you answering to a question about how can a restaurant or how can restaurants adopt to delivery apps in time record? Because that is what happened during COVID, right? Like some very traditional restaurants had to change in 2 weeks or less to adapt to Uber Eats or Didi or something like that. So is that your research question? If you need to more or less visualize what do you want to study, what do you want to answer. If that can be one option. Maybe another thing is like, I was talking with other guys about IMSS, Infonavit, and ISTE, no, sorry, IMSS. Ah, yeah, digital transformation in the accounting of government organizations like SAT, IMSS, Infonavit, all of this. And I think we came out with good ideas because maybe you will agree with me if you have some experience in this, but I think SAT is the one that has transformed better into a digital environment. It's not perfect, of course, but if you compare SAT with IMSS or with Infonavit, I think SAT is better. And then if you compare that with if you compare IMSS with the other two, IMSS is like in the middle, and then Infonavit is the worst. Like you have to do everything by hand and you need to go to the office. So if you see these three examples, it has like 3 degrees of digitalization. So if you want to answer, if your research question is more about what are the technologies associated between these three organizations and what's the outcome of that, then I think you are more in the objective side because you want to maybe measure the level of investment into technology and the outcome. Maybe Infonavit hasn't invested anything. Maybe that's the answer, right? It is possible. And then you can bring out that conclusion. And you don't have to stop with only three because three wouldn't be enough to generalize statistically. Maybe you can gather data from a lot of government organizations, and I don't know, maybe do a huge statistical analysis, well, not huge, but a larger statistical analysis. And in the end, you can measure if really the level of investment affects or doesn't affect the digital transformation. If that is your research question, if your research question is, does financial investment affect the outcome of digital transformation? Maybe that's it. Another thing that maybe you can focus is on on explaining something. So if you're explaining something, your research question should be a why or how question, like why is there resistance in hotels to become more digital? Maybe it is possible. So you want to answer to that question, why? So you want to answer to that question not in a way of saying, because Juanito doesn't like technology. That's not interesting for theory. You need to theorize that answer. We are going to see that later on. But if your question is, why do hotels don't like to be digitally transformed, then you are more on the subjective side because you want to understand rich detail of why people do this. So usually why and how questions are more on the subjective side. Usually what questions are more on the objective. So I think this is the second question. This is the second question you should be asking yourself. What are you trying to understand? And finally, the last question, but probably this is what's going to set your methodology in the end, because I think 99% of the time it works like this. But in the end, in your paper, you have to write a little bit about these two things, maybe in one paragraph. That's why I'm already starting that discussion. But in the end, I think what really is going to decide what you are going to do is the data that you have. So if you have a lot of data from different organizations around an area or maybe Mexico, around the whole country, or if you are going to use public data that maybe it's in Bloomberg, or if you are going to use a huge data set from the World Bank or from, I don't know, any organization or something like that, then you are in the objective side because you have a lot of data from different organizations, and that's the perfect set for a positive objective paper, statistical analysis, things like that. However, if you have access, rich access to a single case or two cases that are very interesting, like maybe imagine if you have access to a restaurant, a small town in a very small town in Jalisco, for example, and that restaurant transformed itself to use Uber Eats. I think that's very interesting, and then you will have enough detail if that's the case. I hope you have enough data. If you can go and interview the owner and ask him, why did you change? How did you change? Who was against this change? Who was in favor? Who left the organization? Did you hire someone else? If you ask those questions and you get answers to that, you are completely on the subjective side of research. So. It is a matter of that. I was joking with some master students about this because I told them that usually when we develop our understanding of love through our life, we usually use a subjective approach because in an objective approach, the ideal will be to have like 500 dates and then you change, I don't know how much money you spent, if you open the door or not for her or him, if you open the door in the restaurant, if you went to the movies or you went to the park or things like that. So you could have like 500 observations with different variations, and then you run out of statistics and you end up saying, this is the most important thing that will bring success to a date. And then you have like an objective explanation, but that's impossible, right? I think like who has enough money and time to have 500 dates? And then even if you have 500 dates, you're not going to be the same person on date number one than on date 227. It's going to be very difficult to control for so many things. So sometimes it's impossible to make an experiment like that. And then you forget about objectivity. So we develop our understanding of love through a very subjective methodology. First, we have like a common knowledge about what is love from what we see in the movies, from what maybe our friends, even our parents tell about that. Maybe we can see our parents how they go on dates, and then we kind of build some understanding of what is to have a date. And then later on, we start doing field work and gathering data, qualitative data. You have your first date, you go out, maybe basing all of your behavior on movies or I don't know. I think our first dates weren't the best dates in any of us, but you go, I don't know, happy and excited, and then something happens, and then you say like, oh no, this doesn't work. So you build knowledge from cases. you build knowledge from your first case, and then you maybe, I think in my first case, I talk about Pokemon or something like that, and it didn't work out well, so I say no more Pokemon ever, and then it was the first thing I learned, and then you start building up more knowledge. So that's really a good example of subjectivity in building knowledge. So I hope this is clear in how can you choose the proper methodology and method. I've started first with the methodology. So ask these three questions. And this one, the last one, should be the most important one. Also, this last question about what data do you have, it's also the most important question to be asked when you want to decide what method you are going to use. So if it is going to be a case study, or a comparative case study, or maybe three cases, or maybe an industry case, because that's also possible to do a case study of the whole industry. You can even make a case study of a single department in a large organization. Like there are a lot of cases like this in, for instance, Deloitte or British Petroleum, or these large organizations where they have different departments. So here are some examples. If you have two cases, you should do a comparative case study. If you have access to two hotels, then do a comparative case study. Sorry. If you have a large survey, or if you have a large data set, then do a statistical analysis. You don't even have to gather the data. Or if you are inside of what's happening, if you are already working in the organization that you want to study, you should do an ethnography. An ethnography is like a case study, but you are an insider. The person who is writing the paper is someone who is in the organization actively doing things. So if you are in the organization that you want to study, and maybe you took a decision or something like that, that is an ethnography. And here is also another quote that I think it's not that cool as the other one, but it says this it was a discussion about research methods, suggests that the philosophical paradigm, that means this ontological and epistemological stance, and the research question and will determine how you are going to collect the data and analyze that data. So it's a mix of everything. I see it as two dimensions. Like one dimension is very philosophical and very theoretical, and the other one is very practical. So you have these two dimensions, one on top and one at the bottom. And with the methodology, you mix these two dimensions. It's the point that you find between these two things. You think that digital transformation, it's something that affects the organization. It's something that affects how people talk with other people, how people use technology. That maybe you think that's digital transformation, and then you find a case that will give you enough data to understand that thing that you are asking, that you want to know. So I think that will be the end of this. In the next video, I will explain what we are going to do, because I hope that this was more or less clear. Of course, if you have any questions, come to the Zoom class and ask me if you have any questions about this. Maybe you have a lot of questions. That's fine. Usually in a master degree or in a PhD degree, there is a whole course about this single lecture. Imagine that. There are so many things you can learn about this. But I try to make it super, short, or not super short, like, summarize direct, concrete in what you are going to study. It's like, I'm not going into very deep discussions. I'm only showing you how can you define your methodology and your research method.